At this point, one other duty that's actually a pleasure is to introduce our moderator for this panel, both a friend and wonderful colleague from Emory University, Ben Druss. Ben's the Rosalynn Carter Chair in Mental Health at the Rollins School of Public Health at Emory, and has been involved with us on virtually everything we do. So Ben, welcome.
Thanks, Tom, and thanks, Mrs. Carter. It's such an honor to be here and to be able to tee up this really wonderful panel here today. So in keeping with the theme of the meeting, I want to make a few brief comments on where we've come from, where we are, and where we're headed on this path towards integration. My goal will be to provide briefly some conceptual scaffolding for the presentations, which are going to focus on current issues in public sector mental health and substance use, as well as the private sector. So let's start the story in 1977 with the Carter Commission on Mental Health. The White House executive order establishing the commission requested as a first priority to identify how many people in the country had a mental illness and how many of them were actually receiving treatment. Pretty basic questions, but ones to which the field simply didn't have answers. In compiling the data for the report, Darrell Regier noted that there were very limited epidemiological or health services data to inform the estimates provided to the commission. He did conclude that based on what was known, that the mental health system really wasn't a system at all, but rather was a de facto collection of uncoordinated services and providers. So, in response to the recommendation of the Carter Center Mental Health Commission to fill that gap in knowledge, the National Institute of Mental Health initiated the Epidemiological Catchment Area Survey, which was fielded across five U.S. cities, and which the data collection ended in 1984, the date of the first symposium. The data for the first time indicated just how prevalent mental disorders and substance use disorders were. The study found that almost 30% of the population had a mental or substance use disorder in any given year, more than twice as high as had previously been estimated. It also reported on the high rates of comorbidity for substance use in the population. Having a mental disorder resulted in a threefold increase in the odds of having a substance disorder, and more than half of those with a drug disorder had a comorbid mental disorder. Finally, it reported that most mental health care wasn't actually delivered by mental health providers, but rather by primary care physicians in the general medical sector. In 1990, Ron Kessler's group conducted the first nationally representative survey of mental disorders in the United States. As the study's name suggested, the National Comorbidity Survey highlighted the problem of overlap among mental health, substance use, and medical conditions of the United States, with only 14% of the population having more than half of all lifetime disorders. Furthermore, fewer than 40% of those with a lifetime disorder had ever received treatment. So by the early 1990s, we knew the high toll of comorbidity and high rates of unmet treatment need. We just didn't know what to do about it. In 1995, Wayne Caton published the first study to improve depression treatment in primary care using a team-based collaborative care model. During that time period, researchers, including Bob Drake, demonstrated the benefits of integrated dual diagnosis programs, providing both mental health and substance use services through a single team. And then beginning in the early 2000s, we began to see multi-site studies that demonstrated that these programs could be scaled up and delivered across a variety of different treatment settings. By the end of the last decade, we saw the development of interventions designed to treat both medical and mental health conditions at once. We saw an evidence base that was increasingly applicable to real-world practice settings, but we also saw very limited uptake of these approaches into real-world settings. Political scientists have argued that policy structures, like biological systems, typically do not evolve gradually, but rather through a process of punctuated equilibrium, in which long periods of inaction are interrupted by periods of dramatic expansion and change. Since 2008, we have been in a Cambrian explosion within the U.S. health system, with landmark federal legislation, state experiments, and community innovations. These hold the potential to support the growth of population-based approaches such as medical homes and accountable care organizations, and more widespread opportunities to address the problems of comorbidity and fragmentation first identified more than 30 years ago. The current task for all of us now is to ensure that we get the job of implementation right. We need to work to make sure that projects that are developed reflect the best possible evidence, that we carefully evaluate the new policies and demonstration projects, and that we use the information from those evaluations to inform future iterations of health reform. So I'd like to end by suggesting that when we meet again in 2044 for the 60th annual Carter Center Mental Health Policy Symposium, that I hope that we've moved to a post-integration world. And by this I mean more than just that services will be less fragmented, but rather that we'll be done with the term integration altogether. We need to move past the goal of pushing two or three systems together and instead look towards the opportunity to truly think about meeting the full range of medical, mental, and social needs of populations with these conditions. We need to think about how to partner with other community and social services organizations in providing that care. And finally, we will always need to keep the mental health system focused not only on treating symptoms, but on improving the lives of the people that it serves. Among our medical colleagues, this concept is called patient-centeredness. For our community, this is recovery. And it should be true north on our compass as we move forward on the road ahead. So now I get to introduce the panel for today. We're going to start with Dr. Mark McGovern, who is a professor in the Department of Psychiatry at Dartmouth University and one of the country's experts in building linkages between mental health and substance use services. Thank you.
Good morning. It's very nice to be here. I have to admit, when invited to speak, I usually say no. In this instance, Dr. Bartlett called me pretty much out of the blue and said, I'd like you to come and talk with us in Atlanta at the Carter Symposium. And just reflexively, I said yes. And I feel personally indebted to the Carters and the Carter administration for their service to our country, and it was immediate reaction. So here I am in Atlanta in November. So I was just thinking about Dr. Druss's comment about where we might be in 30 years. I do work with the Navajo tribe on an integration project, and this Navajo leader came up to me at one point and said, "Mark, your information is so old, it's new." He said it's really Western man and Western science that took us all apart into small little areas, and now you're talking about putting us all back together into a whole. So I'll start off with that bit of irony. So I don't think there's any way you can read this, but I'm going to try to read it. This is an email. I get maybe three or four emails like this, or phone calls with this sort of request. Basically, it says, I have a family member who suffers from extreme anxiety, depression, and recently diagnosed with bipolar. He has been off medications. He has been self-medicating with alcohol and drugs. I'm going to try to read it this way.
He has tried numerous treatment facilities and said they deal with dual diagnosis, yet once we get there, we find that that is not true. One place left felt by offering a medication class in the evening, they were dealing with dual diagnosis. And then they go on to ask me
for a recommendation, for a treatment recommendation. And I live in Vermont. I work in New Hampshire. It's a very small part of the country, right? A small northeastern corner of the country. And these emails, obviously, Sue does not identify where she's writing from. It turns out she was writing from Missouri. So she's asking me for a recommendation for a treatment program in Missouri. And I do my best to help. But what this indicates is that, in some ways, we don't know a lot about the types of programs that offer integrated services. And I'll try to explain to you this morning a model we've developed, an operational model that actually can get at that fairly concretely. So Dr. G.Druss also talked about, dating back to Daryl Regier, the ECA, and Kessler's work on the National Comorbidity Survey, co-occurring disorders are common in the general population. They're even more common in clinical settings. They're associated with negative treatment outcomes, and they're associated with negative life outcomes. For you policymakers, they also cost more money. There is historically separate administrative structures at the state, federal, and local levels, separate provider organizations, different licensing and credentialing requirements, licensing and credentialing requirements for facilities and individual providers, separate funding streams and patterns, an overall scarcity of resources, and the sensitivity and competition. So when I first saw mental health policy, I asked myself, are they including substance abuse in mental health policy? Is that part of what is meant by mental health? Or if people talk about behavioral health, do they? Because I'm often the substance abuse guy, right? So are we also talking about substance use? So sometimes that requires clarification. Different models of care for people with co-occurring disorders, the separated model, which is not the best model, right, where we treat the disorder as if it's separate. Sequential model, where we think we treat one first until it's stabilized, in the hopes that if it's stabilized, then we can go on to treat the other condition. Concurrent model, which sounds good. We're treating both at the same time, but we might be doing so in the absence of collaboration. It might be a parallel kind of treatment. And last but not least, integrated. Integrated sounds like a good word, doesn't it? It sounds like the thing we would want. It's very, very, it's like organic. Very, very positive word, but what does that really mean? So integrated treatment approach, policy, system, and expert recommended. A SAMHSA report to Congress, the Institute of Medicine Quality Chasm Report, President's New Freedom, that's President Bush, New Freedom Commission on Mental Health, World Health Organization, the American Society of Addiction Medicine, all have recommended integrated treatment as the optimal evidence-based treatment for people with co-occurring disorders. The good news is that it turns out, much like that email, that patients seem to prefer integrated treatment. No surprise there. So a recent systematic review, maybe not so recent, 27 studies found that patients and families prefer integrated treatment. Where can you get it? Sue couldn't get it. Sue couldn't get it for her family member. So if we ask providers if they offer integrated services, what will they say? If we ask consumers, what's their personal experience getting integrated services, what do they say? And then if we have an objective, independent tool to evaluate integrated services, what might we learn from that? Well, if you ask providers, I heard the answer from the audience. The survey says correct, 84%, which means what about the other 16%? They don't know the answer to the test. So 84%, yes, we offer integrated services. Our provider surveys about 75%. Marketing materials, if we were to go to some of the high-end treatment program websites, 100%. along with our swimming pool and health and massage and yoga facility. But it's really a caveat emptor situation, right? We really don't know what's there for sure other than what these people are telling us. This is I'm from Vermont, so I would call this a cheese chart. You might call this a pie chart. So you can see that the majority of people with co-occurring disorders don't get treatment. So I think that I'm really looking forward to Ray's talk later this morning from a public health, population health perspective. All the people with co-occurring disorders, most are not getting any care. That next to smallest slice of the pie or the cheese says that about 8% are getting services for both their mental health and substance use disorder. So that's pretty poor, isn't it? And that means they could be getting concurrent parallel care. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're getting integrated care. The estimate of integrated care is actually about 2.2%. So 1 in 20 chances of getting the most optimal evidence-based care for a co-occurring disorder in this country. Not good. Unacceptable. So we've been involved in trying to develop some measures of integrated service capability. The first one is called the Dual Diagnosis Capability in Addiction Treatment. The second one is the Dual Diagnosis Capability in Mental Health Treatment. The third one is called the Dual Diagnosis Capability in Healthcare Settings. We've actually had to revise that third one because it was misunderstood. In primary care settings, people didn't know what we meant by dual diagnosis. They thought maybe we meant hypertension and diabetes. They weren't sure that what we meant, that it meant something to do with behavioral health. So the dual diagnosis capability in addiction treatment measure is called the DDCAT. We're fond of acronyms, right? So it's the DDCAT. I didn't know that the DDCMHT could be converted to an actual term, but it's been called the DDMUT. The C is silent. And the DDCHCS, for the life of me, I thought we're clear of animals, but at a meeting someone said, well, that's clearly the DD chicks. So the DD cat, the DD mutt, and the DD chicks, these three measures. And there are more, and I'll tell you about them. It's a whole barnyard. So the methodology of these objective measures, Dr. Druss also mentioned Bob Drake, who's my mentor. So we drew heavily on the fidelity measure methodology used to evaluate integrated dual disorder treatment. Basically involved a site visit by independent evaluators. It's a mixed method, which doesn't mean chaotic method. It means a qualitative, quantitative approach where we interview folks, we do ethnography, which is what anthropologists call deep hanging out. And we review documents and basically look around as much as we can to get a feel for the culture. We triangulate the data and make objective ratings on integrated policy practices and workforce elements. We rate these observations on a 5-point scale. And we care about psychometric properties. So we assess reliability and validity. And as a psychometrician, I can tell you that it's a never-ending process. There are different 5-point scale ratings. So we go from a 1, addiction-only or mental health-only services, to a 5, dual diagnosis enhanced. So MHOS or AOS, DDC or DDE. This is a map that SAMHSA put together to describe, I guess we call it the penetration of the measures across the country. I see Michael Hogan here, who was at the time from New York. New York is soundly represented using these measures to document organizational and systems capacity to deliver integrated care. By the way, this map, the first version of this that was produced was red and blue. And folks thought that was a little provocative, so we changed it to these colors. A little easier, or not as easy to read, but less apparently provocative. So this is the results of the national survey, or site visit, not a survey, of U.S. data on addiction treatment programs. And I know this is hard to see, But it roughly says that about 18 to 19% of addiction treatment programs offer services at a dual diagnosis capable level, which means that that big green area, 81%, offer services at an addiction-only service level. In other words, not particularly well prepared to deal with comorbidity, not offering services for comorbidity, even though roughly 60% of the patients have comorbid disorders. The next slide is going to be mental health agencies' national sample. So I just would ask you to develop a hypothesis before I show you the results. Mental health agencies, they would be higher or lower than 19% in offering integrated services. How many of you would say higher? How many of you would say lower? You guys are good. 9%. So half. This was a surprise to me. I work in a department of psychiatry at a large, well, not so large, medical center in New Hampshire, and we would fall into the 91% of places that offer mental health only services, despite, again, high rates of comorbidity. The good news is that through various quality improvement, implementation, and change processes, programs can elevate their capacity. They can move towards dual diagnosis capability. In the addiction programs, they went from 24%, is that right?
14%
to 44%. So roughly, I must be shooting something with this, 14% to 44% dual diagnosis capable. So a threefold increase. Mental health programs went from a 7% to a 32% increase, so five-fold increase. Which means, and this is 103 agencies across 13 states, addiction programs, 54 programs across six states, mental health programs, including Missouri, as it turns out. So we used a measure called the Implementation Index, the II, to track what programs did to make those kind of changes. We had support from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. We asked the agency leader or change team leader what they did. We asked them for the types and numbers of activities. We asked them kind of retrospectively, not prospectively. This instrument, with all due apologies, has no psychometric properties. It is the II, though. We thought we got away from another animal with an II, but it turns out a colleague of ours from Delaware brought me this on his smartphone after I presented the measure, and he said, "No, Mark, there actually is an animal called the II from Madagascar." It's these animals follow me around. So, from the II, we learned a few things that, and David Chambers is speaking later this morning, so he can talk with you a bit about implementation science. But defined implementation strategies, targeted quality improvement strategies, do seem effective. Contextual factors, including leadership, a hero, having a hero, is really, really important. So if you're with an organization and this is something you're interested in, be the hero. That's the secret story of what works to make these kind of changes, that every success has a hero. Hard to measure that, by the way. Evaluation and measurement, it turns out it helps to count and measure and keep track, hold people accountable. These last ones are pretty interesting, right? Everybody thinks, well, it's about training. If we train our doctors, if we train our nurses, if we train our counselors, if we train our therapists, then we'll be able to do it. No evidence for training. No evidence for money. Right? We ask people if they got an infusion of resources or changed billing or financing or changed staffing patterns. No evidence really that any of those things made a huge difference, statistical difference, an outcome. Outcome being the progression from addiction-only or mental health-only services to more dual diagnosis capable. Okay. Is there a way I could advance the slide, given that this might not be working? Okay. So I think So 30 years ago, I was at on an emergency room fellowship in Northwestern Hospital in Chicago, 1984. That was wild. But we really offered integrated emergency room services. We took all comers. It was integrated behavioral. By that I mean mental health, addiction, and medical care in an emergency setting. We address chief complaints. The other piece that I guess I would want to convey is that measurement is essential. It really turned out to be important to have these objective measures of integrated service capacity. But it's kind of surprising how hard it is to get people to accept measurement. Many folks seem to prefer that realm of, well, it's kind of organic, it's kind of integrated, we'd like to tell you that it is, but no, please no objective yardstick. Some states have actually incorporated the measurement to define payment structure. So Connecticut, Idaho, two very different states, you would have to agree, use the measure to categorize programs to inform payment and also to inform consumers where they might have a better chance of getting their co-occurring disorder addressed. We learned, and we have some projects up and running that I haven't had a chance to tell you about, that using implementation science methods as they are, we found that the implementation science holds a lot of promise to actually improve integrated service capacity in programs that we work with across the country and actually Navajo Nation, which is beginning to put folks back together again. Healthcare reform, and I think Linda is going to be talking about the implications for the Parity Act and the ACA on the potential transformational disruptive change opportunity to support foster integration. And I have to say, Dr. Druss and I talked about this earlier this morning, that we are talking a lot more about behavioral integration in medical settings. And I'm involved in a few different projects in this regard, and it's really interesting. I have psychiatry primary care colleagues who are working to implement depression screening and intervention in medical settings. I have addiction treatment colleagues who are working to implement screening, brief intervention, and referral to treatment for alcohol use disorders. I have addiction treatment colleagues who are working to implement integrated treatment for drug use disorders. Another group working to implement interventions for opioid use disorders, including prescription drug abuse. It's as if everyone is a special interest group lobbying medical care settings to get their particular expertise kind of in the 15-minute consulting room. So I put my last line is I tend to worry anyway, so it's just a disclosure. No conflict of interest, but that's my disclosure. But I think if we are talking about integration, behavioral health, and medical care settings, we have to think about behavioral health in a more comprehensive way. It said zero. That doesn't mean the rating for my presentation. It just means how much time I have left. So hopefully I didn't break this slide thing. Thank you.
Yeah, I can't get it to work either. Okay, so our next speaker is Linda Rosenberg, who is the president and CEO of the National Council for Behavioral Health, which has been a real leader nationally in improving collaboration and integration of services in the public sector safety net. Thank you.
So a full disclosure, Mark is a worrier and I'm an optimist. So I'm gonna take a slightly different tack in terms of looking at a glass really. Certainly, I think more than half full. Let me first thank you for allowing me to be here, John and Tom, and of course, Mrs. Carter. My first slide is a slide I like because it shows a woman, and I love the comment last night about all the men standing behind behind Mrs. Carter. This slide and quote from Roseanne Barr always reminds me of mental health and addictions, because we always feel like we're behind and like we're not invited to the table. And I guess my approach is nobody ever gets invited. You have to figure out how to show up. But after last night, I got back to my room and I thought about a much more appropriate quote for being here in the Carter Center, and I actually wrote it down. It's from Isaac Newton, and it says, "If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." And we have many giants in this room, and certainly Mrs. Carter has been our touchstone and our giant in so many ways. So it is a privilege. My next slide, and if I can't use my, someone's doing it for me. I was going to tell you how fabulous my slides were, but obviously now you're going to have to see them for yourself. Certainly, I think that in many ways, parity and the ACA have institutionalized integration, certainly as a policy, if not in practice. And there is, of course, a difference between policy and practice. And we got what we wanted, right? We wanted equality and we got it, and now some people have mixed feelings about it, I think. So I'm going to try to do three things very briefly. I want to talk about, you know, the achievements, where we are. I want to talk about the current healthcare environment in which we are now full players for good and for bad, and I want to entertain some possibilities for the future. So in terms of the public, there is an interest in mental health and addictions like I certainly have never seen before. And in some ways, it was the result of some very serious tragedies, Aurora, Tucson, Sandy Hook, the opiate really explosion across the country. And we see it at the National Council every day in partnership with Missouri and Maryland. We have a program called Mental Health First Aid, and we literally are training every day between 500 and 1,000 Americans on mental health literacy. So the interest is enormous. I think the other thing, and now I'm going to try to advance this, certainly it is also the best of times in terms of addictions. We have very far to go, but I think we are at a tipping point in terms of understanding addiction as a chronic medical condition and not as a moral failing. Understand recovery is possible and treatment works. And certainly for the National Council, we're trying to walk that talk by a recent merger with another national association focused on addictions. It's the best of times because healthcare really has taken their head out of the sand in some ways. What they're realizing is that untreated mental health and addictions add costs and complications to medical conditions. And so we are making great progress there. And when you look at the work of Jeffrey Brenner in Camden, the beginning of hot spotting that Joe Parks took to Missouri in another form, when you look at the dual eligible programs in multiple states, and you look at hospitals being punished for readmissions, that all points to a need for integration. We certainly, I think, are at the best of times because in many ways, behavioral health has led in the integration dialogue. We've not lagged behind. And in fact, if you think back, certainly I'm thinking back, Charles Ray, my predecessor at the National Council, is here. He was talking about integration, I think, 12 or 15 years ago. The SAMHSA study, eight-state study, Ram Landeshide is here, who is an author of that study. That was 8 years ago, I think, now. So we've really been moving ahead, and certainly in the National Council, we've had the ability to see this both because of the center we run for SAMHSA and HRSA. We run an integration center in Ohio and New York, and we see hundreds and hundreds of members every day who are in some stage of integration. Just had a discussion with a Georgia member about their struggles here to integrate between behavioral health, the community boards here, and the FQHCs. Everybody is working on this in one way or another. I think, but it is at the same time, it's the best of times, it's also very complex. And it's complex, we think, in terms of three issues. One is the service and payment redesign that's underway. There is a monopoly economy, which means although you have a job, you may be getting your check from somebody different in the coming years. And there is a technology revolution that we're just beginning to acknowledge and really beginning to think about how it's going to affect us. I think if we look at service redesign, all of you know this, it's about reducing institutional care, it's about integrating the delivery system, and it's about population health. And I know Ray, who is a far more expert in this area, is going to talk about that. And we have models, right? Health homes, accountable care organizations. And for those of us who've been around for 30 years or more, we have seen the end of state hospitals, the development of a siloed system of community services for people with serious mental illnesses and people with addictions, and now where I think of it as a third phase, which is really an integration phase and part of being part of healthcare. But what's coming along with this is an alignment of payment structures to go along with new integrated settings and certainly to go along with ownership and responsibility for populations, case rate, bundled rates, capitations, and ultimately being at risk. Being and running an organization that provides services where you have some degree of risk. One of the implications of this is you need size, you need margins. And so we're beginning to see the kind of mergers and acquisitions that you see generally in the business side. We certainly are seeing members becoming part of big hospital systems. We're seeing big hospital systems become members of the National Council in recognition of the importance of behavioral health to their overall operation. And I think we're beginning to see big data, right? We come from a world, those of us in mental health, where our work took place behind closed doors. There is going to be great transparency. We're going to be benchmarked against each other. We're going to be measured in terms of outcomes. Those are all big changes for many of us that came up in this very siloed world. And I think certainly for consumers and for staff, there will be a fundamental shift. I think when we talk about a workforce crisis, I always have two kind of responses in my own head. One is, first of all, I have a young staff that is far brighter and more talented than I was in my 20s and 30s. So there's great people coming up behind us. I think they just need me probably to get out of the way. And I think the other thing is that in every industry, technology replaces or extends staff. Think about the last time you saw a bank teller, and think about the last time you went to an ATM. We're beginning to see that in terms of handheld devices, remote monitoring, online communities and treatments, and I think we're going to see more of that. So we're moving from a silo to a quality, and that means a lot of turmoil. You know, contracting with managed care, collaboration with new players. How do you get the attention of a big healthcare system? How do you get the attention of an FQHC? How do you really standardize your treatment so you can offer it in multiple sites and you can bear risk because you know what your costs are? How can you really deal with competition? We have members that are operating now in multiple states. That is going to be the norm, not the exception. And the question of whether big hospital systems, which are now becoming insurance companies, are going to buy it from the siloed mental health and addiction world, or are they going to build it themselves? And can you compete in that? I think the other thing, that the way we're looking at it, is there really are two roles in an integrated world for specialty behavioral health. One is to provide behavioral health within a medical setting, whether it's a big hospital system or it's a, you know, an FQHC or it's an ambulatory practice. I was on the phone with a member in Colorado who's operating in 10 physical sites. Some are pediatric pediatric practices, and some are general adult practices, and she is doing very well, but payment hasn't caught up, and so she struggles in terms of covering her overhead. We think and believe that with the new payment structures, that that will be more possible and more plausible. And so that's one way really to go. And the other is, if you're going to remain a freestanding specialty sector, whether it's mental health or addictions, we think you need to be a center of excellence. And we have a whole host of definitions around that. But if somebody's going to buy it from you, you've really got to be good at it. First of all, they have to have access. And they certainly can't be told that they can see somebody in 6 weeks. So there's a lot of work to be done. And although I'm an optimist, I'm also a realist. And so we have a ways to go. The other thing is really that we think we have a game changer that kind of slipped by in this year and went along with what was called the Doc Fix, and it's something called the Excellence in Mental Health Act. And it is a demonstration project that will take place in 8 states, but it's going to put about $1.1 billion in Medicaid money into the mental health and addiction world. And there are different elements of it, but I think what it begins to do is it goes back to an original concept, which was a community mental health center that really served the community. And of course, I'm looking at Mrs. Carter and Tom and some of the giants here, but it is within an integrated world. And so there is responsibility for a population and integrating within to the larger healthcare system. But it begins to level the safety net playing field, because it also has payment structures that support good evidence-based practices, and will also, we believe, and SAMHSA is actually here, is working with CMS, and I was on the phone with CMS and with Pam last night talking about it, there will be incentives to actually have outcomes that prove that you're really making a difference in the life of the population that you're serving. So I'm going to end with just a charge, I think, to myself certainly, and to everyone at the National Council, and I think to all of us. This is really a time to be fearless, to have really a bias to action, not to be paralyzed, to take risks without being reckless, and certainly being disruptive if it will elicit improvement. And the other thing is to realize there are lots of jobs out there. Healthcare is a growing field, and it may not be your organization as it exists today. There will be change because we got what we wanted. We're part of a larger healthcare world, but don't be afraid of that. Be brave and really do what's right for the people you want to serve and have really spent your career serving. So I'm going to stop now and look forward to the questions.
So we're going to move from substance use and medical and mental health integration now to population health. Ray Fabius is the co-founder of Health Next. He's a visionary who focuses on innovative models of population health delivery, and we're looking forward to hearing from you.
It's indeed a great pleasure to be invited here again. I think this is my third opportunity to present before all of you at these wonderful celebrations that this symposium is. And Mrs. Carter, I want to take the time to thank you at this, the 30th symposium. On so many levels, give me a chance to first thank you for the friendships that I've been able to obtain through the center with John and Ron and Tom and Ben, and the new friendships that I've just acquired yesterday and today. I want to thank you as a son of a father who died 25 years prematurely because of the behavioral health illness burden that he had. I want to thank you as a father of two sons who were able to access behavioral health services when they needed them, to get to the point where they are wonderfully contributing to society today as a doctor and as a lawyer. I want to thank you as a pediatrician because of the center's ability to see the future through the eyes of children. And as a behavioral health specialist whose driving mission is to undo what Descartes did. And with that preface, I want to take this time to take you through a few thoughts around population health and building cultures of health. And during the short time that I have with you, I want to talk a little bit about the idea of moving from an illness-focused delivery system to a wellness-focused delivery system. I want to specifically talk about moving from traditional disease management to population health. Many of us in the early days of crafting a better understanding of disease management noticed that 10% of the population were spending 70% of the dollars. Few of us understood at that time that the other 90% were doing nearly 100% of the work in the community. And so when we have transitioned from disease management in our medical management thinking to population health, it's largely with that in mind. I want to explain to this really important audience some of the tenets of population health, particularly this understanding of moving, as we all do as individuals, across the continuum of care. And I will touch on, but hope that there'll be some opportunity in the Q&A section, to talk about the importance of enveloping a population health strategy into an environment and a cultural milieu that supports and drives the opportunity each day to both consciously and unconsciously select healthy choices. And hopefully, again, if there's time, mostly in the Q&A, I'd also like to share with you some of the cutting-edge thinking that's going on right now on the merits of building population health structures and cultures of health. I'm going to start on the sad side, but like the other panelists, I'm going to finish very optimistically. Many of you know these maps, right? Have you seen these maps? So the CDC has actually shown over time how much heavier we're getting as a country. It's even to the point now where I'm not sure you have to worry about climate change for reducing our coastlines. The weight of the nation may actually take care of that for us. But what is really astounding is that wherever you see concentrations of risk factors, in this case obesity, you see concentrations of chronic illness, in this case diabetes. And it's actually interesting that I sit here in Georgia because, as you can see from these graphs, the Southeast is actually leading the country in both obesity and the prevalence of diabetes. What may be a little more surprising is that depression follows suit. And it really doesn't matter what map you want to look at. Risk factors predict chronic illness in communities. We'll talk more about that in a few minutes. So many of you are interested in the topic of population health, and I will not be able to do it justice in the few minutes that I have. But I am happy to tell you that I've written a textbook on the subject. And I also want you to know that all of my royalties, go to the New School of Population Health at Thomas Jefferson University Medical School, where I am on staff. And so as I plug this book, it's not with any personal gain. Thank you. That's so nice. I don't think I've ever gotten applause for that. But let's just, you know, I was once the global medical leader for General Electric. And during the Jack Welch era, he used to say, Ray, I'm a very busy man. I can't read a book. Make us one slide that summarizes the entire book. So that's what I've tried to do for you here, although I still encourage you to read it. Basically, all of us move through a continuum from wellness to acquiring some bad habits, to actually occasionally having acute illnesses that need to be remedied, to acquiring chronic illnesses, and certainly toward the end of our life, experiencing some catastrophic conditions. Any population health management program needs to pay attention to all five of these categories. Our present healthcare system does an okay job here in providing access for acute illness. And they do a pretty good job here in terms of trying to manage catastrophic conditions with intensive care services in hospitals. But the other areas have largely been neglected until more recent times. So let's talk about these five different categories across the continuum. And I'm so happy to have heard yesterday many people speak to this. It was Carl Bell who said Western medicine really has focused on the negative. We don't really even understand wellness. We're just starting to get a grip of it. But certainly we understand that it's much, much more than the absence of illness, for God's sakes. It is really about the richness of one's life in terms of their emotional condition and state, their social status, their intellectual curiosity, their career pathway. And all of these things contribute to a better physical health. Remarkably, so many of these categories are going to require your help as behavioral health specialists. We've already touched on this, but the CDC has told us that 80% of heart disease, 80% of type 2 diabetes, 40% of cancer could be mitigated by healthier lifestyles. There's some work by a friend of ours who's contributed to the center, Nico Pronk, who's shown that in as little as 2 years, when people are not living healthy lifestyles, they tragically have a much higher incidence of being diagnosed with a chronic condition. If you have a chronic condition, you need to be able to manage it using evidence-based guidelines that can minimize the complications of your chronic illness. From a population health standpoint, it means the three I's and the big E. It means identifying the population that you want to manage, who all have the same condition, so you can drive them through a disease management program. It means implementing services that are evidence-based. It means working very hard, and this is especially where you come in, at getting them engaged to participate and to work their way all the way through to what you folks wonderfully call recovery. And then to manage the impact of that. So the three I's are identification, intervention, and impact. And the big E is engagement. And we all have to get on board with this because the incidence of chronic illness is escalating at remarkable rates in this country, partly for good reason, because of how long we are living. It's also important for us to address catastrophic illness, and this is not easy for us to do. among my roles has been to be the chief medical officer for Thomson Reuters Healthcare, also known now as Truven Health Analytics, arguably the largest medical database company in the country, perhaps the world, with information on 95 million American lives. And during that time, it was like a candy store. I could search this database for things that I wanted to look at. And I asked our data wonks to look at the amount of money that was spent in the last year of life for patients who actually died in a hospital, because we had a clear code then of them passing, and it was easy to look retrospectively. And you can see that so many patients are having, in this orange segment, between $100,000 and $500,000 of medical services in the last year of life. We all know that in the last year of life, 90-some percent of all of your medical spend is going to occur there. Does that make any sense? We need to spend things up front despite this fact. I'm so sorry to show you that. We're not able to stop this from happening yet. But let me tell you what the great gift of wellness really is, and Mrs. Carter is a shining example of this. How many people are familiar with the concept of compression of morbidity? I'm so happy to share this with you. There's increasing information every day in the literature that's counter to the argument that Zeke Emanuel actually just put forward, which is it really doesn't matter how long we extend people's lives. Eventually, we're going to still have to spend $500,000 with their chronic or catastrophic condition in their last year of life. It's not true. My wife comes from a very strong farming background. The number one disease that they suffer from is going to bed one night and passing away in their sleep in their 90s, in their late 90s. Didn't cost the healthcare system a dime. Nobody was terribly upset about that. They lived glorious and wonderfully vital lives from the day before they passed away. They were working on the farm. We now know that the longer you give people the gift of wellness, the shorter their time is where they suffer from morbidity. The purpose of healthcare is not to extend the period of morbidity, which you could argue our present healthcare system is doing right now. It's to extend to the greatest extent the period of wellness. You know, my beloved Philadelphia Flyers were in the Stanley Cup Finals a few years ago when the guy who we should have drafted shot the puck from an impossible angle in a tie game in overtime, and the Flyers lost the Stanley Cup. I was so upset because they lost in sudden death overtime until I realized that's the gift we all should give people. Sudden death in overtime. So this graph, I think, is one of my favorites. It shows you a person going through this continuum. This is a young person's x-ray who's healthy and well, and they decide to take on smoking. They're treated several times in the hospital for bronchitis episodes. Nobody's terribly concerned about that, but each one of those acute illnesses scars the lungs, just like this cigarette smoking does as well. Eventually, these repeated episodes of acute illness and the noxious fumes of the risk factor of smoking lead to emphysema. And at some point, the immune system can't keep up with all the mutation that's going on in the lungs as a consequence of all of this, and they get a catastrophic illness, lung cancer. Where should we be helping people? At what stage? A unfortunately, the answer in population health theory is all of those stages. But we really ought to be paying a lot of attention up front. Let's try to get this person not to smoke. It translates into your field as well. I mean, first there's normal stress, and then there's burnout, and then there's depression, and perhaps suicide. Where do you want to help these people? All across the spectrum. But you want to create increasingly more focus around here. You want to create my version of resiliency. Not resiliency here, resiliency here. Or in terms of alcohol addiction. I mean, it starts with an occasional social drink, but may go on to binge drinking, and may go on to alcoholism, and then cirrhosis of the liver. Where do you want to help these people? At every point. But you really want to focus here. Let's try to make it so that we stop at this point, which, by the way, is very healthful. I recommend 2 drinks of red wine, 2 glasses of red wine every day. Oops, sorry. So here's where it comes back to all of you. Remarkably, all of population health reduces down to one thing: behavior change. And as a primary care provider, I could have benefited by having a behavior change specialist next to me all of the time. The great frustration that doctors always speak about is my patients don't listen to me. I tell them what to do, but they don't listen. And I'm pleading with you to not just focus on schizophrenia. Please, don't just focus on chronic depression. These are important, I understand it. My father suffered from a very serious condition, a bipolar condition, often in depression. But you need to help all of us upstream. Take those people with risk factors and get them to change behavior. Get those people with any chronic illness and get them to abide by evidence-based guidelines. Help us with the comorbid chronically ill who can't actually turn their diabetes around until their depression is turned around. These are the things that we need you to focus on now in terms of primary, secondary, tertiary, and even primordial prevention. We need you to work on helping us create communities of health and cultures of health. We need you to work on lifestyle change, on early identification, and help us with the management of the chronically and the catastrophically ill. So let's look for a second through the eyes of a child at what we can possibly achieve in terms of our goal. Let's create environments that seek out ways to prevent illness and disease, that reward better health and outcomes, that are holistic and stigma-free, promote individual and collective well-being, produce resiliency at each stage in the continuum, and enhance the performance and the prosperity of communities as a consequence. Thank you very much.
Mr. Dunn. So we have some questions from the participants. And I want to start with one that is directed at all of the speakers and where I'd be interested in all of their thoughts about it, and it's spread out over 2 cards. One of them was specifically targeted to Dr. Fabius, the other one was really to all of the speakers, so I want to start with that. Given all that we've heard over the course of the symposium about the broader societal factors impacting the mental health and overall health of our nation, what role have the agencies represented here, or the fields represented here, played in engaging other sectors such as education, housing, justice, in developing the solutions to our mental health challenges? And then there was a related question about economic security and wellness. How, you know, where does economic security fit into wellness, and how can we think about addressing that?
You think I'm going to answer a question about how we're going to address economic disparity? I think you should do that.
Well, I'm happy to do that part, but you might want to talk about the community, the larger community. You want to talk about that? All right. My pleasure. Okay. The interesting evolution that's taking place in the private sector is that enlightened human resource. I was so happy when David Shern spoke about human capital yesterday. Human resource, enlightened human resource leaders are realizing that it's not just an accident that they're responsible for the health benefits of their workforce, but also their 401k. And in my field of population health and cultures of health, there is this evolution that's taking place from just aspiring to promote wellness to promoting well-being. And there's no doubt, as has already been mentioned in this symposium, that there's very strong connection between economic status and health, and that actually has been borne out at the individual level, at the community level, at the state level, and at the national level. We need to treat people in a holistic way, which includes a much greater understanding of their economic status right now. A great way to help people is by helping them career path, if you want them to be healthier. There's a great big data doc in Wyoming, Hank Gardner, whose research has shown that the more people make, the more likely they are to take care of themselves. And he's even at the point of just saying to employers, don't give people any benefits. Don't give people any 401k. Just pay them as much money as you can pay them. They will work things through from there, but they'll take better care of themselves because their income's going to jump $10,000, $15,000. I don't agree with that.
I was going to say, you must be a Republican. that's a particular, I couldn't resist, sorry.
I'm making that just a point as an example of the strength of the literature, which really does show a very strong connection between health and wealth.
Yeah, I just want to add two things. And one, obviously, if you look at who dies first, even if you look at the work around people with serious mental illness who die early, you're talking about people who are living in poverty. So I think it is the social determinant of poverty that needs to be addressed. And what we have in this country is increasing income inequality and very stark differences of how to address that. So I just want to say that. The other thing, part of the question, which is about criminal justice and housing, I have to say that's what I do all day, every day, is meet with Corporation for Supported Housing, with TASC around criminal justice. I mean, there aren't enough hours in the day to do the kind of collaboration people are interested in doing. There is a great spirit of collaboration, I think, and many very strong leaders in all those sectors. And they're all actually looking, and I think it is happening, to the ACA and the increase in insurance coverage to allow some of these problems to be addressed. And I think that's a very good thing. So.
Yeah, so it's a great and complicated and ultimately unanswerable probably a question. But I was thinking about, I reveal that I live in Vermont, and our governor, Shumlin, who's been reelected, which I think is pretty good, was on record earlier this year to declare the opioid epidemic in Vermont the major issue for his administration. And we literally made the cover of the Rolling Stone. I don't know if you saw that. It had a kind of a maple syrup can with a lumberjack, you know, banging a syringe into his arm while he's seated on a stump. So I think what I learned in various state meetings was that it's not a health care problem. It's not a law enforcement problem. It's not an education problem. It's not a housing problem. It's not an employment problem. It's all of that. And the message was, and this may be more possible in a place like Vermont, although we have our own challenges during the rural and wintry and mountainous conditions bringing people together, but the solutions for at least the opioid epidemic, and many people with opioid use disorders, as you know, have comorbid mental health issues, including PTSD and bipolar disorder and things like that, not to mention medical conditions. But the solution was at the community level, you know, bringing people together to try to solve at their own kind of Rutland community, Windsor community, White River Junction community level. How are we as citizens going to make this happen for our fathers, our kids, our spouses? And I mean, something as simple as having absent landlords, it makes a huge difference in rates of crime and drug addiction in a community. So is that a healthcare problem? Is that a law enforcement problem? So who's responsible for that? So I think, I don't know that the question is answerable, but to the extent that we remain in silos and not good citizens, part of community, and I really like what Linda framed the issue is, and this is with respect to Mrs. Carter, is we rally around tragedy, which is unfortunate, but I'm sure all of you are in this field for a particular reason. I hope you're not in it to make money. If you are, you made a bad, very bad career choice. But there's something about this that's very meaningful to all of us, and I think to the extent that we use that passion to fuel getting invited, that will make all the difference. So my answer is at the community level, that's how we do it.
Linda, there were a couple of questions around the Excellence in Mental Health Act. The first related to the opportunities under the Excellence in Mental Health Act to address these issues of integration, medical care, social services that we've been talking about. And then the second was how you see the implementation process rolling out. What are the things that we as a field need to be thinking about to make sure that it fulfills its potential?
I would first, it's really a call to action. I would encourage all of you to be talking with the leadership in your state about applying for the planning grants that will become available next year. You have to have a planning grant to be a state that participates, and any state can get a planning grant. So that's the first thing, because it's an opportunity. The problems we face are very complex problems, and there isn't just one solution. I wish there were. But I think the Excellence Act is certainly a tool in the toolbox for the states that go forward. Certainly the sponsors of the bill and the champions, Senator Stabenow from Michigan, Roy Blunt from Missouri, really their vision is that this will happen nationwide. And this was just a down payment. And I think what it does, and again, I run an association, and in some ways we're a trade association. This is not necessarily good for all of our members. Again, not everything is good for everybody, because it's going to require some size and some scope. You're going to have to be able to be a player in the larger healthcare world. And you're going to either have to deliver population health in all of its aspects, or contract with entities that deliver other things that you don't, whether it's addictions, if you're a mental health, or if you're primarily addiction, it's mental health, primary care, either have it as part of your organization or contract with it, and really a responsibility for a rate that will also allow you, and the expectation, and you will be measured by, actually implementing evidence-based practices in all of those areas. So we think it's an opportunity.
Thank you. This is a question that was directed to all of you, but I perhaps wanted to start with Mark. We're in a rural state, once you get outside of Atlanta, here in Georgia. And you, of course, as you said, are from a state that has a large swaths of rural areas. How do you think about these issues of integration as they pertain in particular to rural populations? What are some of the challenges? What are some of the opportunities that we can think about moving forward?
Yeah, and I think we all know the challenges. It's hard to make traditional appointments. People in the substance use world have lost their licenses because of driving under the influence, yet are expected to make an appointment at a clinic at 10 a.m. During normal business hours, over a mountain. So, in providers, I sort of laugh when I think about we use the term patient-centered care, and the reality is that we've constructed a system of provider-centered care. So it's really about us and our schedules and how patients have to fit into that. So what have been the solutions? I think technology has really been helpful, at least in the states of New Hampshire and Maine, and Vermont, using technological devices for patients to empower patients in terms of recovery management, symptom management. So smartphones, cell phones, I believe the latest data are that 90% of the population in those states are subscribers to some a network provider for phone service. So we've actually found that if we can extend the work of clinicians through technology, that helps. We've done a fair amount of telepsychiatry and case conferences. We as a medical school and medical center in a kind of the bi-state Vermont, New Hampshire region, we can play a role working with providers via telepsychiatry and grand rounds and case conferences. So we've done much work around learning collaboratives, practice improvement collaboratives regionally, and bringing people together as part of networks. I think it's a major issue. And rural, the map that Ray showed us, I of course pay attention to where I live, and we're never the right color on those maps either. I noticed that some of the states did not report data, which Pennsylvania did not report data. It's kind of interesting. So I think we're rural environments are particularly challenged, and I don't know that there are easy solutions, but I do think that technology holds some promise there.
Ray, go ahead.
I agree, and I've seen wonderful ways that technology has been applied to the rural population. And in fact, I actually was in Juneau, Alaska, in the early 90s with a project through AT&T, where a patient who lived in Juneau with advanced arthritis was being cared for by a rheumatologist in Seattle at the Virginia Mason Medical Center. I do want to comment that it's not just a rural issue. All of us are very excited about the progress of the patient-centered medical home, but I'm actually out there on the stump trying to eliminate the medically homeless. In analyses that have been done, I mean, at one point in my career, I was the population health strategist for Walgreens when they were putting retail clinic nurses into their drugstores. And I was quite insistent in developing a methodology so that a report could be delivered to the primary care doctor with every visit where a nurse practitioner took care of a patient. We created a kiosk that made it very easy for the patient to just point and click on their primary care doctor, because we listed them all within 30 miles of the drugstore. 40% of the people who were seen out of the first 600,000 visits, with 98% being commercially insured, reported that they had no place to send a report. So we have some very heavy lifting to do everywhere if it's true that 40% of the American population does not have any relationship with any trusted clinician.
I just want to add one or two things. Number one, I got my flu shot at Walgreens this year, and it was fabulous, by the way. Easy, simple. So I think what we're beginning to see are new players in the healthcare market, like pharmacies, right? Costco also gives flu shots. That's one thing. The other thing is I think there's a connection between being provider-centered, which I think we are, and actually I was in New York City at a place called the Child Mind Institute. 2 weeks ago, I was there in the evening because I was going to have a dinner meeting. I was shocked that not only were they open, they were mobbed with families with children. That is very different than most places that treat children, which close at 5 o'clock, even though kids don't get out of school till 3 and parents work. So I think we clearly are provider-centered, and I think technology will answer some of that also because people like me, I order something on Amazon Prime every night. We are become, really, my husband, every time I come home, says you have 3 boxes waiting, right? It's convenient. I love it. I don't go, you know, to certain stores anymore because I can do it, you know, with a click and have it a day later. So I think that's the demand that the population has. And so being able to get treatment via your laptop and your telephone is something people very much want. And we're doing wonderful things in Africa and in Haiti around that kind of treatment using community workers. And again, peers were the first community workers in many ways. So I'm optimistic again.
a couple of questions for Ray, but Linda and Mark are also welcome to answer about it. So thinking about operationalizing this idea of population health, particularly within employed populations, the first question was kind of how is that being done in a systematic way? Are there approaches such as mental health first aid that are being used by employers? You know, how are they kind of reaching out to their employees? And then the second question is around uses of incentives and penalties related to population health approaches and some of the potential unintended consequences that could come up from, you know, for instance, penalizing smokers or people who are overweight.
The place of work is a terrific location to deliver consumer-centered, patient-centered services. For many people, it's where they spend the majority of their waking hours. And so embedding EAP, for example, or behavioral health services at the worksite, or primary care at the worksite, or episodic illness care at the worksite, or pharmacy services at the worksite, all make great sense. And there's research that I've published to show the remarkably higher engagement rate, better outcomes, higher medication adherence, and it goes on and on. So in terms of trying to move from being provider-centric to being patient-centric or consumer-centric, I would encourage all of you to explore ways where you can deliver your services where people work. In terms of incentives and rewards, there's a wonderfully rich science that I encourage all of you to explore called behavioral economics. It winds up that human beings respond to incentives in actually remarkably irrational ways, but they're predictable. And in fact, there's a great book by Dan Ariely, who's an expert in this space, entitled Predictably Irrational. For example, in terms of incentives, I'm so sad to tell you this because as a human being, I'm not happy with it. But people are 3 times more likely to respond to taking something away from them than giving them something. So, for example, if you say, I'll give you $100, dear employee, if you do a health risk appraisal and a biometric screening so that you can know your numbers, that's one approach. Another approach is to say, we're putting $100 in your health spending account, and if you don't do a health risk appraisal and a biometric screening, we're going to take it away from you next year. That generates three times higher participation rates. So, I mean, keep that in mind as you explore incentives and rewards. The other point I would make in terms of incentives and rewards, ultimately you have to switch people inside a culture of health so that they're pursuing their health and their recovery because of intrinsic motivation, not extrinsic motivation. There are very good studies to show that to get people to do something over a long period of time, you have to pay them more and more money. That's what raises are all about in the business world. When my kids were little, I used to give them a quarter if they got an A. By the time they were graduating high school, they wanted a car. So it's a very slippery slope when you focus on extrinsic reinforcement.
Okay, so I actually have a question that builds on a brief discussion we were having before the panel. And I want to start with Linda, but also hear your other thoughts. We were talking a little bit about, Linda's going to be going to London right after she's here, and we were beginning to talk a little bit about how a lot of our conversation around both the last 30 years and current policy efforts have been turned inward. What can we learn looking outward at other countries, either about what they're doing right, what they're not doing right? How can we begin to have a dialogue that's looking outside as well as inside?
And you know, I'm going to London for a day-long symposium The Economist is doing about depression. And I just want to quickly say we haven't touched on the business aspect of healthcare. And I get at least one call every week from either a hedge fund group or a private equity group or the group that's doing research for them about opportunities in mental health and addictions. We may feel squeezed if we're providers, other people see this as a very fruitful area for commerce. So I just want to add that. But you know, we have some members in Europe. We're part of several different international groups. And what, you know, very naively when I came to this position, I thought, well, having a single payer system of some kind would solve so many problems. But you know what? They have the same conversations we do. And I have the same conversations with them, certainly around integration. In some ways, we're ahead of other countries, even in terms of population health, and even in terms of countries that have very strong primary care systems. So I'm always surprised that there's a commonality. People talk about workforce. The same issues seem to resonate across the world.
I'd say, you know, one area that I've always been impressed with when I travel outside of the United States, related more to the social healthcare structures of other countries, is they're less inclined to focus on healthcare costs and more inclined to focus on productivity and performance of workforces. That is a very important next step toward getting all of the business world and enterprises thinking about the merits of a culture of health. It winds up in very good substantiated research over and over again in the literature that for every dollar you spend, dear CEO, you're losing $2 to $3 of productivity. And in Europe in particular, they're much more focused on trying to look at healthcare as an investment in human capital for the purposes of improving productivity and performance than in this country, where we are often focusing on how we can minimize healthcare costs. It's the wrong focus.
Well, let's thank this panel for a very stimulating discussion.